Hello, I'm Graham and I do hope everyone's having a great day. Welcome to today's video. Now, if you, like many of my other readers, are still struggling with the concepts of aperture, shutter speed and ISO, then hopefully this video is going to explain those three parameters for you. Now, the exposure of a camera depends on three parameters. One is going to be the aperture you've selected, the second one is going to be the shutter speed, and the third is the ISO. Now, we'll break those down into their component parts. A lens system has basic components of its focal length and its aperture. Now, there is a ratio between the aperture and the focal length, which gives us what's called an f-stop. And it's probably better explaining this on something like an old film camera, where cameras like this had dials which showed you the shutter speed and aperture rings which showed you the actual aperture you've selected. With our modern digital camera, we don't have those dials. They've been substituted for mode dials to give us the opportunity of selecting different types of film situations. But by and large, they don't have shutter speed or aperture control rings. Now, the film camera was very tactile and gives you immediate feedback on when you were changing our aperture. So, for example, if I change the aperture ring on this camera, you can hear the click stops. With the digital camera, you don't hear anything like that. You just see a scale change on the camera. So, in many respects, the film camera was much easier to comprehend when you were learning photography. With a lens, whether it's a interchangeable lens camera, such as used on the Micro Four Thirds systems or DSLRs, or this old film camera, the aperture consists of a number of metal blades which are constructed in a way that gives you a perfect circle. So as you change the aperture, you're changing the diameter of that circle. That aperture controls the amount of light which is allowed to reach the sensor or the film in the case of this camera. So that is the first part of the equation. We can see the amount of light which will be controlled by the aperture. And it has an aperture scale, and with this particular lens goes from f3.5 up to f22. Now, those f-stop numbers are the ratios between the hole in the diaphragm, the hole in the iris, and the focal length of the lens. So if you divide the focal length of the lens by the size of the hole, it gives you the f-stop. And that's a mathematical relationship which stays with any lens. So whether it's a 28mm lens or a 35mm lens or a 400mm lens, that f-stop number is that ratio of the focal length divided by the diameter of the hole. So it means that that f8 will give you the same amount of light whether it's a 400mm lens or a 28mm lens on any camera system. Now, the aperture also determines what's called depth of field, and depth of field is a zone of focus that we consider acceptably sharp from the closest point to the farthest point. And that depth of field will change not only with the aperture setting but also on the focal length of the lens. So if you wanted the maximum depth of field, you'll choose a wide-angle lens, something like the 28mm lens, and you'll focus towards infinity and you'll get the maximum depth of field. If you wanted a very shallow depth of field, if you wanted to isolate parts of your subject, then you use a longer focal length and you'll focus closer too. So with something like the bridge camera, which has got an inherent large depth of field because of the sensor size, then you will need to use extended telephoto settings and get the subject as close to the camera as you can and keep the subject as far away from the background as you can, and that will give you this nice shallow zone of focus. So aperture determines the amount of light which will reach the film or sensor. And if you look at my analogy of your curtains in the house, if you want to let more light into the house, you open the curtains. And it's the same with the aperture. If you want to let more light into the camera, you open the aperture. And you go to a smaller number, so you'll go to f2.8. If you want to reduce the amount of light that comes into your room, you'll close the curtains. Same with the aperture. You'll close the aperture down. You'll go to a larger number, like f8. Now, if you change the amount of light that reaches the film or sensor, to keep the exposure right, you need to change the shutter speed, which varies the amount of time that that light is allowed to stay on the sensor. So if you let more light into the camera, to keep the exposure the same, you need to reduce the amount of time that that light will fall on the sensor. And that's the purpose of the shutter in the camera. Now, if we look at this particular camera, you'll see we have a shutter speed dial, and the shutter speeds go from 2S all the way up to 2000. Now, 2S is 2 seconds, so the longest exposure time we can have with this camera is 2 seconds. But what about the other numbers? The 125, 250, 500, etc. Well, they are actually fractions of a second, and they are really 1 over 125 or 1 over 250. So they are 1 125th or a 125th of a second. I guess because there's not much room on the dial to engrave all of that, the decision was made just to put the fractions part, the denominator, if you like, of the number. So 2000 really is 1/2000th of a second. Now, the numbers on the shutter speed dial follow an internationally agreed increment, and it's the same with the aperture. It's an internationally agreed increment between each of the numbers on the lens, and they are what are called f-stops or EV numbers. So one f-stop change would give you double the amount of light, or half if you go to a smaller number. And it's the same with the shutter speed. So if you go from one shutter speed faster, you will half the number, and if you go to one shutter speed slower, you will double the number. So for example, if you're at 1/500th, if you go to a 1/125th, you are shortening that exposure by 4 times. If you go from a 1/125th to a 500th, you are shortening that by 4 times. So just to recap, if you're at 1/500th and you go to a 1/125th, you're extending that shutter speed by 4 times. If you're up to 1/125th and you go to a 500th, then you're shortening that shutter speed by 4 times. So we have now two ways of controlling the exposure. We've got the aperture, which controls the amount of light reaching the sensor, and we've got the shutter speed, which varies the amount of time that that light is allowed to stay on the sensor. That brings us to the third component of exposure, which is ISO. And ISO is a way in which we can change the overall camera sensitivity to the light falling on the sensor or the film. Now, again, it's an internationally agreed system of ISO 100, 200, 400. It's an internationally agreed system. And if you like, the ISO is a way of changing the amplifier gain of the amplifier between the little photodiode, the pixel, and the analog to digital converter, which converts the light into electrical energy, which the camera can digitize and use in its digital processing system. And it's like an amplifier in an audio system. If you turn up the amplifier, of course, you'll hear a louder noise. But in association with that, if there's any noise in the system, that noise is amplified. So even with the lowest amplification we have, so ISO 100, we still see a little bit of noise in our system, because that's the electronic noise generated by the photodiode itself, by the amplifier, by the analog to digital converter. All these things introduce electronic noise into the system, which is then digitized and becomes part of the system. The higher your ISO number, the higher this gain is, so the more noise you'll see on your image. And that noise tends to soften the image down. So in general terms, you always want to keep the ISO as low as you possibly can. It's my recommendation you always use the base or native ISO, unless you've got to move away from that because of the lighting situation. So with your bridge cameras, always select the lowest ISO and you'll get the best image quality out of that sensor. If you are forced to use a higher ISO, then limit the ISO you use. With a bridge camera with a 1/2-3 inch sensor, don't ever go above 400 or you'll destroy the image. With a Micro Four Thirds system, you can probably go up to 800, and with the crop frame DSLR, you can probably go to 1600, and with a full frame DSLR, you can use ISO 3200 and above. But generally with our bridge cameras, stay under 800 ISO and you'll get the best image quality. With the semi-automatic modes, the camera will make the choices for you. So if you've set the ISO to the lowest number of ISO 100 and you set the aperture to f4, the camera will then evaluate the light and set the right shutter speed to give you the correct exposure. Now, if you change the aperture to a larger aperture, if you go from f4 to f2.8, the camera sees the amount of light has increased. It's actually doubled onto the sensor, so it will reduce the shutter speed by a factor of 2. So if the shutter speed was a 1/125th and you've gone from f4 to f2.8, you've increased the amount of light, so the shutter speed will go from a 1/125th to a 2/50th to compensate for that and make the exposure the same. So in summary, our three components of exposure, the exposure triangle if you like, is the aperture, which controls the amount of light reaching the sensor or film. It also dictates the amount of depth of field in the subject. The second one is the shutter speed, which changes the time that that light is allowed to fall on the film or sensor. And it changes the amount of subject motion blur. So if the camera is open for longer and there's any subject movement, you'll see subject motion blur. So to capture things like sports or wildlife, birds in flight, you need to use a very short shutter speed, a 500th or even at 1000th or 2000th, if you wanted to stop any subject motion. Remember, the camera optical image stabilizer is only there to stabilize your hand movements. So if you've got any handshake, that will eliminate the handshake, but it won't take away any subject motion blur due to the subject moving in the shot. And that third component is the ISO, which changes the camera sensitivity to the ambient light that's around. So again, if you have the lowest ISO, you've got the lowest noise possible in the system. Change to a higher ISO to get the amount of light for the exposure, you'll suffer from noise in the image. So life's a compromise. Be aware that aperture controls the amount of depth of field, shutter speed controls the amount of subject motion blur, and the ISO will affect the amount of noise you've got in the image. So armed with those three facts, you should be able to go out there and take some better pictures. Have a look at my photographic blog, you'll find lots more information about aperture, shutter speed and ISO, and about camera systems in general, and in particular Panasonic Lumix bridge cameras. I'll put a link to that in the video description below. And if you're a new viewer to the channel, please do click that subscribe button. It really does help. So until the next video, thanks very much for watching. Please take care. I'll see you all in the next one. Goodbye for now.